Maria Callas has often been compared and contrasted to great sopranos of the past. Well, there's not much that John Steane doesn't know about historical recordings. All those hissy wax cylinders from singers you and I wouldn't even know how to pronounce. So we thought he was just the man to place Callas in the wider historical perspective of opera singing. How, for example, does he see her in relation to another great Norma of the past, Rosa Ponselle?
Rosa Ponselle certainly is the name that nearly always comes up first for comparison in this kind of discussion. To my mind, it isn't really very apt, because Ponselle's great gift was this wonderfully opulent voice, not really Callas's type at all. Ponselle's was very warm, well-rounded, with a mezzo depth to it and even at times contralto. She had a reserve of rich, thrilling top notes, but she was a bit reluctant about using them. There were many of Callas's roles, Lucia or Bellini's Elvira, for instance, that Ponselle wouldn't have sung. She wouldn't have dreamed of singing Turandot, which Callas did quite often in her earlier years. I think that in the combination of dramatic and coloratura parts, which was one of Callas's most striking achievements, there really is no immediate comparison. For something nearer to that, you have to go back to the great German soprano, Lili Lehmann, in the 1880s and 90s. She was a famous Isolde and Brunhilde, as well as a Violetta and Norma. But even then, granted a sort of documentary correlation between these two, Lehmann's school of singing and her style were very different from Callas's. If you want to draw a line back, it really has to be within the Italian school. And, despite great differences even here, in all but the extremes of high coloratura and the heaviest dramatic parts, there is an affinity between Callas and one of Ponselle's leading contemporaries, Claudia Muzio. Claudia Muzio in the start of the aria Poveri Fiori from Chilea's Adriana Lecouvreur, a recording made in 1935. You've got those dark chest tones, which were so thrilling with Callas, and of course there's that charged emotional intensity, which is the very soul of Italian operatic tragedy. Muzio was a greatly admired Violetta in La Traviata, and she did sing Norma and Turandot, though I can't somehow quite imagine it. Otherwise, after Muzio, it's back to those emotional dramatic sopranos heard on very early records, Esther Mazzoleni, Eugenia Burzio, Giannino Rus, and the more aristocratic Salomea Krushinsky. In fact, there aren't exact earlier counterparts on records, though at least there's a line there, a recognisable connection. For the nearest thing to a real counterpart, you have to go back further still, to the 19th century, and the creator of some of the major roles in Callas's bel canto repertory. That's Giuditta Pasta, who who was the first Norma and the first Amina in Bellini's La Sonnambula. Here, the descriptions really do tally. Pastor had extraordinary qualities as a stage artist, an expressive singer. And in spite of a dazzling technique, there were also inequalities in her singing, quite serious ones, and yet somehow subsumed in the power of the total effect. Henry Chorley, the English critic, wrote about her, saying that though he felt he knew in advance what it was that she was going to do with any particular passage, when the passion broke out, or when the phrase was sung, it seemed as if they were somehow new, electrical, immediate. Pasta was also the original Anna Bolena in the opera by Donizetti. As we listen to Callas, it may be something of Giuditta Pasta that we are hearing too.
John Steane, putting Callas' singing into a historical context.